Spoiler alert, they all die.
Yeah. Oh no. Well, I guess I should change my background then.
Okay.
Maybe not.
Maybe I'm not. That's a good, I think that should be your background forever.
Actually, I wish this bear was in the Bader Meinhof movie. That would have been more enjoyable.
Inside my head this morning.
I'd totally forgotten that the Iranians used to wear, the Iranian students at Berkeley would always wear these paper bags over their heads when they would be protesting the Shah.
And they would be the Shah's face, right?
We weren't just into Bumblecore.
I want to make some joke about how that bear could only be in the film if he were naked, but I guess a bear is naked. So.
And his shit's
You saw the first half of Bader Meinhof, which means you saw the naked half of Bader Meinhof.
Yeah, you saw the better half, Jared. There's very, very few tits towards the end.
Yeah, actually,
there's a lot more killing of capitalists.
Right in the beginning, though, when they're on the beach, you know, I was like, it's weird to see like naked little kids and then naked adults all playing in the water together.
Right. Yeah, because they don't have those hangups.
Is Silt a naturist beach?
No. Silt is just a really popular place. It's north of Friesland, so it's at the very far northwestern part.
Near the Danish
before border. You get to Denmark.
Uh-huh.
And people, most beaches in Europe are like nudist beaches.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I think it's very cool. I just wish we weren't hung up on.
Except for England.
In England, you're required to still wear 1930s bathing suits.
Straw hats. Straw hat.
Boaters.
I think that's
you go into
cool
your
too.
Ankles in the water, but that's it.
if you show a wrist, they arrest you.
That's right. They like the old rules out there.
Right. And old-timey piano music plays while you frolic in the waves.
Oh, that's fun.
And there's men with large mustaches who are lifting up big round balls that say 100 pounds on them.
Yeah, they're pressing them over their head.
I'm telling you, though, on the boardwalk, the opium drinks are great.
Yeah.
I mean, that's still my favorite part about going to Atlantic City.
It's the opium drinks.
Opium?
Yep.
I'm just going to put my quarter
in. You would say that.
Put your quarter in.
My quarter is on the table.
Oh, we're getting serious. Chris has something to say.
Great fucking pick, Tad.
Yeah, thank you.
How did I not know about this friggin' movie? Shows how clueless I am sometimes. I'm actually a big fan of the director, Uli Edel. I really like Christian F. I really liked Last Exit to Brooklyn, even though it's grim as fuck. I know he made
this movie's also grim as fuck in its own way.
You made one or two shitty Hollywood movies after Last Exit to Brooklyn. I think one had Madonna in it or something. Body of Evidence, terrible.
Yes.
But this was, I love movies like this. And actually, one of the nicest things I could say about it is I went down the Wikipedia rabbit hole for like 2 solid hours when it was over, because I remember vaguely the notion or hearing about the RAF as a kid, but I didn't really have any perspective or like, you know, that just beyond the surface level, I had no idea. And I thought that this movie moved really, really well. I thought the performances were great.
The acting in this movie is amazing.
The acting's really good. It really had a great, like, I actually think this would be a good double bill with Stander.
I legitimately thought about picking this with Stander. Like,
yeah,
this
it would have been a killer double bill with Stander, because like the sense of place I thought was really good. It crams, I will say, there is a lot crammed into this movie, and at times
good job of editing it all.
At times it feels a little breathless, like boom, 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 onto the next.
And then it's like 3 months later.
Yeah, but then it finds like somehow then it knows when to sort of like pause, take a breath, get into something. I could see why it got all the acclaim after the fact. I saw that it was nominated for like best foreign, but I would have never caught this had you not recommended it, and I'm glad I saw it.
Yeah, me too. It's really good.
I just want to talking about why I picked this. I've been thinking about this movie literally since we watched Run Lola Run.
Because, oh wow!
Well, because he's in this.
Yeah.
And as soon as I started watching Run Lola Run, which I hadn't seen since it came out, I was like, "Fuck! I want to watch Bader Meinhof again." Because he is so compelling, like he is so good at being
Leibtrau. I can't remember his first name.
Leibtrau,
yeah, but I forgot his first name.
Yeah,
Ulino.
That's the director.
Yeah, But he was really good. His character was really hard to define. He was a charismatic, but he was also a real asshole.
Yeah, he's a piece of shit. Andres Bader was a piece of shit.
And he continually justifies the terrible things he does the entire film. It's awful to watch.
And he treats everybody around him like shit too.
Yeah, that's a thing. Yeah.
But I don't think you can be a revolutionary without being kind of a piece of shit. I
don't know if I agree with that.
If you're going to go out and you're going to kill people for your ideology, if you're going to go out and kill people for your ideology, there has to be part of you that is disassociated from the rest of humanity.
I'll agree with that, but I still think that the people who are in your revolution, you could probably treat pretty well, and this guy doesn't.
No, he's got
a weird charisma, and I think that's why people followed him.
Yeah, like Manson or Jim Jones.
It's cult adjacent.
Yeah, right. It is cult adjacent. Okay, yeah. Well, these guys are all overeducated, so they'll talk about in length about the politics of what they're trying to do. And
it's what happens always when you have free.
Every time they do something, they run a sieve of whether or not
it's good and free public education, Jeff.
I know.
Free
public
education. Yeah. I feel like
that's why we don't have that anymore.
Yeah. It's an argument against. So give me
the 60s happened.
But he also has Ulrike Meinhof as the person who translates what he's saying into a more intellectual and palatable version of it. And that's really what helps him. She was an amazing writer. So that really helps in the long run of attracting more people to the cause.
You know, I thought it was interesting to see that the guy who was like the head of the anti-terrorism unit, and they're like, we're here to talk about how to stop terrorism.
You mean Bruno, the chief of police?
Yeah, Bruno Guns, yeah.
Yeah, Bruno Guns, he starts advocating for understanding their cause and what their beefs are, and everybody else is like, what are you on their side? And he's like, no, you have to understand these people. They have legitimate, you know, reasons for what they're doing, and you need to understand that.
Or you have to understand them.
At least.
Well, that specific scene, too, where he starts talking about, like, Israel and Palestine and all of that other stuff, where he's just like, they're not going to give up. Like, this is, war doesn't exist in the way we think of it anymore.
Right.
Like,
one of the first people to recognize
this is the
that.
Future.
Uh-huh.
Right, and that's what, it made me think about it, and there was that other line about nobody wants to see, you know, warfare brought home into where they live. They want it to happen in some other country far away with, you know, people of different color or whatever. If it happens in your house, you know, suddenly it's an atrocity.
Well, and that's what the RAF did, is they brought the wars back to Germany.
It was a demonstration of that. Absolutely. Yeah.
I feel like I've seen this movie many times. I feel like I'm not particularly drawn to these kinds of movies. I know that you need to have movements and revolutions, and those things are all good. But I don't know. I didn't finish this one, but I've seen this movie before, and I don't like it.
I don't think this movie asks you to agree with what they were doing. It's more of a straight ahead depiction. And you
right. And I'm not saying
what I admired about it is it was very.
I'm not saying it's a message movie, although I don't know. Maybe it kind of is.
I mean, there's.
I do think like that guy is pretty repulsive and like. I mean, it's funny how like we had a lot of people like thinking that Alfie was like a piece of shit, and a couple other characters we watched. I think this guy's a much bigger piece of shit.
Like Alfie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this guy's a much bigger piece of shit than most characters we've seen in films that we've watched.
Alfie just wanted to get laid, but they were basically the same guy. Right. They just had different goals.
Although it's interesting, after the whole debacle in the Swedish or in the German embassy in Sweden, he's like, no, you don't kill civilians.
Don't
kill.
I will say he's a good actor, though, because I loved him in Run Lola and I hated him in this. So that's a compliment.
She writes that whole apology when the bomb goes off in the newspaper office about how, like, we don't want to kill workers. Like, they left those workers in there because they didn't take us seriously,
right?
And like, that is the difference to me in this versus a lot of other characters, is both of them are very much like, we have put a line down the middle, and if you're on this side of the line, you're okay, and if you're on that side of the line, we can kill you. And we're not necessarily going to, but if you hurt us, we will hurt you back.
Right.
And that, I think, is it's at least a cohesive worldview, which is not a thing that you get out of a lot of kind of violent characters in other movies.
Well, it's the rules of engagement. It's like war. Right. Again, it's like wartime rules. You don't kill civilians, you kill combatants.
And they can fight. So I got the impression watching the film beginning to end is that they had some ideas about what they want to do. You know, from when they first started becoming political and becoming like an armed, you know, the Red Army, the RAF, right? One of the stories they're telling is they're changing the rules as they go along because they don't know where they are. They're like, no, we're going to rob banks. No, we're not going to hurt anybody. You know, we're going to start hurting people. And it's like, you know, how do you react to the Munich Olympics? Are we going to support that or go against it? I thought it was all contingent from beginning to end. They were stuck. Once they started being revolutionaries, they had to stake out claims as the film progressed. And I thought that was kind of interesting. It was an examination of how portable morals can be.
Well, I mean, it's legitimized when countries do it. They have embassies and they decide what their policies are towards other countries and what the other countries are doing.
Yeah.
You know? So you could argue that that's a fake distinction.
Yeah, maybe. Although most countries, until very recently in the United States, they don't make it up as they go along. We were making it up as we went along the last 4 years in this country.
Trump was definitely making it up as he went along. Yeah,
exactly.
I don't know. We were making up as we went along in Vietnam.
Well, that's true. That's actually a good example too, because everything kept changing about that world.
Sure. You know, that's why I'm saying it's a fake distinction, because we just justify what we want to do in, you know, moral terms.
No, I'm not saying it's good or bad. I'm saying it's just an examination
of that process. You know, you can see these guys kind of like trying to, you know, their ultimate decision at the end, which I won't spoil, was obviously something they came upon near the end. They realized they had no more options, you know? Right. Yeah. And that was it was just fascinating.
I understand there is some level of debate on whether or not that was an intentional act or not. At least that's
debate about whether they really did commit suicide.
Right.
They cut away.
Which I thought was nice, because Adele doesn't show you any of the suicides.
Yeah. Ulrike might have been killed. She might have killed herself. I'm not sure. They hid it. They did not show it.
Right.
Yeah.
They do show you multiple times during the movie the police being excessively violent towards people.
Yeah.
So I honestly do think they killed themselves. I think they got to the point where they realized they weren't going to get away with it. Like, the trial was going against them, everything was going against them, and they did. But if you believe they didn't, or you think there's a possibility that they didn't, I think that's very valid considering everything else that happened. It's one of the funny things to me is that I've seen people say that this movie is very fair to both sides. And I think it is very fair to both sides. And then where you come down politically decides how you feel about whether that fairness is good or not.
So it's kind of a Rorschach test, basically.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Uh-huh. And that makes sense for a movie that was made with a bunch of public money in Germany. And then also another thing about this is it's not mentioned in this movie because they were long dead when it happened. But in 1989, the remains of the RAF killed the chairman of Deutsche Bank. They literally got a shaped charge weapon from the Stasi and set it up and blew him up in his armored Mercedes. And until 2007, there was no proof that the RAF was involved. So when this movie was being made is when they finally had proof that the RAF was involved in that. And that fucked with the perception of the RAF. Some people got way more in favor of them and some people got way more opposed to them right at the time this movie was being made. And I think that's also really interesting as far as this goes, because again, it depends on how you feel about that act. And so much of this movie comes down to how you feel about whatever particular action they're doing.
Sure. It was interesting to see the trial, which was open to the public, was full of supporters. that were jeering the judge and jury and clapping for the
and cheering when they were talking shit. House,
the deltas.
Yeah, you wouldn't see that kind of thing in the United States.
No, absolutely not.
Yeah, there's also a bit near the end where just before the ultimate thing happens, where they're wheeling in breakfast, and they all have this really nice breakfast—the egg and the little egg cup. I'm thinking, man, they take really good care of prisoners in Germany.
They have TV sets,
bookshelves. I know. It was like really
tea, coffee makers.
It was really nice.
They were in what we would consider a minimum security prison at that point in time. It was almost like a county jail. So because they were during trial.
That's why they were together too. Yeah.
Yeah.
But since they have a history, the Germans, with treating their prisoners bad.
Yes, they kind of
they've overcompensated.
I went the other way a little bit. That's smart.
No, a lot of Europe does this. Sweden and Norway, if you look at a prison there, they look like college campuses.
I remember the baguettes the Prophet. I remember those.
They don't have as many incarcerated people per capita as the United States do. We got
that helps. No one does.
That helps a lot. You know, the smaller prisoner population.
Yeah. Well, China technically doesn't because they just farm them out to factories.
Send them out to the Gobi Desert to and then they never heard from again. Yeah, that's not good.
Percentage-wise, still fewer than America.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, that was a heck of a film. I admit.
No, that blonde that was behind me a second ago, like I forget to mention, like her performance was really good, like because she was just like borderline like psychopath.
Oh yeah.
She threaded the nice line between like ideologue and nutcase. I thought she was great, and
who played Esalen? Girlfriend?
Yeah. She was like out of her mind half the time in terms of
I thought
thing is, she was like really angry, really wanted to strike out, and she was sharp too. She could she could barf up these big political arguments like that.
Oh, when she quotes Mao, when she does that whole thing, when she quotes Mao is so good.
I know,
because you see her winning those people over over the course of that.
She was a born revolutionary, I could tell.
I want to point out that this Stanheim prison is in the video for Deutschland by Rammstein, which also includes a bunch of references to the Bader Meinhof group.
If I had time, that would have been my screenshot, because I thought that was the best shot in the movie.
That was a great shot.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
No, I thought this movie was very well done.
Yeah.
I want to take some shots at it, though. I will admit, I had to push through two movies and I was a little tired, so I was not the most receptive. But I would say the first third was the best third for me. I was sort of indifferent to the middle third, and by the last third, I was kind of watching the clock a little, because I mean, I know there was a lot of history to cover, and they did their best to tell the entire
10 story. 10 years worth.
There's a lot of time to cover. A lot of shit went down.
And a lot of people getting fucking murked.
It got repetitious for me. It was just like, you know, that montage of three bank robberies. I'm like, wait a minute, how many banks? Oh, it's a montage. Okay. There is some, I thought, clumsy filmmaking going on here. I thought the score was like for a Bond movie, and it was inappropriate at times.
I'll give you that.
It was like standard stock thriller kind of music.
Yeah, I thought it moved too fast. When you're introducing a lot of characters, I know you have to move fast.
Because
I only saw the first half. And I love movies where it's not like a central person you're following. It's like a group or many. But I didn't care for the editing. I didn't care for the pacing of it. I thought not only like they're going so fast that I didn't get the chance to really know anyone at first.
Same here.
Sure, you get to over the course of the whole picture, I'm sure you feel that way, but I was kind of like, this is a little bit brisk for my
stayed for a long time. We stayed on those four, and they went to Jordan, and that was a pretty funny scene, by the way. All that stuff,
that whole sequence Jordan. Is really hilarious.
That whole sequence is pretty funny.
Oh, when they piss off the PLO.
yes
and then also that dude who's her boyfriend, and it's like, oh yeah, he's working with the Israelis, of course he is.
Don't worry, I'll take care of you, I'll protect you. And also, her on the roof.
Also, Tad, what is this gun?
That's a G41.
That's a tiny little girl and the biggest gun I've ever seen. That scene,
no, it's an
ambush
scene.
She was like, HK? You can tell she was like almost falling over. It was so big.
It's an HK something or other.
Yeah, I think it's a G41, which is their 5.56 like carbine.
That gun was every bad guy's gun in an 80s movie.
Gal got there and she just wiped everybody out with it. It was like terrifying. Everybody else had Uzis. She had the biggest gun I've ever seen. Like, bah, 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 bah.
Well, so the guns in this movie are really interesting because the terrorists start off mostly using American or Belgian guns. Mm-hmm. And then as they get more successful in what they're doing, killing cops and stuff like that, they start getting more German guns. Mm-hmm. Because they're actually taking them off of the authorities as they kill them. Right. So when it gets to this point, it gets to this point later in the movie, they are using full-on German military weapons. Mm-hmm. Because they've actually attacked multiple army bases by this point.
Right.
So I found that interesting as me, the person I am. But I'm pretty sure that's a G41.
Come for the yelling, stay for the firearms.
Exactly.
Allah Akbar.
Amy, anything else? We got thumbs at this point?
I really like
Jim's Corner.
Yeah, I just wanted to say it's really a movie made for Germans. I don't even think it's made for a European audience.
No.
So there's all sorts of things that are left out that Germans would just know. Like the fact that the last guy they waste, Schleyer, mm-hmm. that they kill him after they cross the border into Belgium.
Uh-huh.
He was an SS officer. He was
I didn't know that.
National Socialist. Uh-huh. And it was a big scandal that he rose to a position of relative power again. And they sort of skimmed over a lot of stuff like that.
The longer version, the director's one cut.
There's
whatever.
A longer version?
Oh, yeah. There's a TV version. It's like Dust Boot.
It was split. It was split in half, and they did two or hour and a half TV versions of it.
So I watched one. It's like 2:22. How long's the long version?
2:49, something like that. Mm-hmm. They do add some of that context back into the longer version of it. That's the original one that I saw.
I assumed everybody, like from Bruno Ganz, that character, and all those guys, everybody that was in the establishment, older guys, were all working in the Nazi government at one point or the other. It's just how it was.
Unless they were like, you know, in the Soviet Union as
exactly.
refugees. The one nice thing I liked about the Bruno Ganz character was him serving soup to the other guys.
That was their soup.
You're so civilized. You should eat something. You never see that in an American cop movie. It's like, some soup.
Yeah. No, that happens in that show, The Crown, where Thatcher makes everybody like toad in the hole of her like
dinner from her entire staff.
I know. That's really cool.
That's how you're polite to people. You invite someone into your home and you serve them food. God damn it.
It's very European. Yes.
Nice. It's just nice.
But also the terrorists do that too. They have people come in and they give them food and drink as well. Like it is one of those things where it's like, in what I was talking about it being balanced, is like, these are all people. Like no matter what they are, no matter what they're doing, everyone in this movie is a person. Mm-hmm. Like no one is a caricature. No one is a make-believe villain. Like everyone has their motivations and their decisions, and it just comes down to whether or not you agree with what they're doing.
Partially,
I agree wholeheartedly.
Ulrika Meinhof's husband, who gets put upon when it's like, they were only going to stay a day, or they were going to do, you know, he several times, even though he's a lawyer and he's probably disagrees with their political motives, he's just sort of like, okay, I'll go stay at the Y tonight or something.
Also, the part where their lawyer goes to the funeral,
and
he's crying while they're all throwing the dirt and the flowers on the coffin, is really affecting. Like that's one of those.
Yuchka shows up, the guy who gets shot by
Yeah.
They haven't seen him in like 3 years or something, and he shows up to throw dirt on the dog.
And he's limping, and you can see the scar on his face from where he got shot. Like, there's also a lot of people getting shot in the face in this movie.
Like three or four times, shot right in the head.
Oh, many times.
And sometimes they get up.
He gets up.
That one guy.
And then he's and then he starts ranting as he's walking down the street with the blood pouring down his face.
But he's, like, I got to go to the barber, he said.
Yeah, the friseur,